background on me. I've been with the department about 6 years now. The bulk of that time has been spent as a claim manager, state fund and self-insurance. So I have a lot of claim knowledge and background, and then in self-insurance I also worked as a management analyst doing process improvements and project work and things like that. So life of a claim. As Susan mentioned, this is about how the ROA comes into our system and gets processed through our system, not so much how the claim, once it's been adjudicated, how it the medical and the vocational and the time loss benefits. You know, that's a different life that the claim has. This is more just how it comes in from the provider's office and gets into our system, and then therefore into OMS for you guys to work. So our mailroom, usually the first stop for any documents that come into the department, that get mailed into the department. So it is the third largest state agency in terms of mail. We are, in terms of mail volume. We get a lot of mail. Think of claims alone, the mail that comes in, bills, medical, chart notes, letters, things like that, that just come through the mail. So in total, LNI has 211 business areas that are served by the mailroom, with about 5,500 pieces of mail processed daily. That means it comes in, it gets opened, it gets sorted, it gets unpaperclipped, it gets unstapled, it gets routed into where it needs to be every day. It's a lot.
It's a post office.
Yeah, it is. It's a mini post office. And 90% of that mail is claims related. So it's a lot of mail that comes in. So a lot of our ROAs do come in through the mail, and so that's how they get processed through there. They also come in through fax, of course, and that's a different process. And then of course we have the file fax, and that's a different process, so we'll get to those. So,
it doesn't go the first time, I have to hit it twice.
Oh.
Don't know why.
So our imaging department, that's the next stop for the ROA. So it comes through the mail room, and it gets sorted and figured out where it needs to go, and it gets dropped off in our imaging department. So our imaging department supports a lot of our operations. It supports claims, bill processing, employer services, crime victims, self-insurance, any department that uses our imaging system to look at documents, the imaging unit images for them. So it's about 80 staff members that index about 2 million pages of documentation per month. In 2015, it was just over 23 million pages of documentation that they image. So a document comes in and it gets scanned into their imaging system, and then somebody has to look at it, figure out what it is. Is it medical? Is it a crime victim documentation? Is it a license or registration? They have to figure out what it is and where it goes and where it belongs, and manually index it. That's what we call it. They assign it a code and they send it to the proper file, whether that's a claim file or an employer file or things like that. So they have to do that for every page, for 2 million pages per month. So that's the next stop. The mail into our imaging system. Once it gets imaged,
delayed response.
It's okay. So once it gets imaged, things that are mailed or go through the imaging system, documents that are faxed, they don't have to go through the mailroom, they just go straight to our imaging department and then get indexed. So that kind of where those two pieces meet. Once it's in the imaging system, then it goes to claim initiation. That's where the ROA is flagged, and it goes to another unit called claims initiation. And at that point, they type the information into the system, into our database system. And that's where they initiate the claim. It gets initiated into our system manually. And they have certain processing times, catastrophic or hot claims. They have to do it upon receipt, right away. With time loss, with about 4 days of estimated work, they have to do them in 1 day. Medical only, 3 days. And then employer ROAs, that's what the EROA is, employer report of accidents, within 4 days. So that's their processing time to get those ROAs inputted and initiated into our system. So of course, you know, the faster you do it, the faster a claim shows up to be adjudicated and then can get processed through our system. So, and this one's a big one. And I know Lorianne. Mm-hmm. So this one's a big one. Mm-hmm. Correct provider to claim assignment. So when an ROA comes in and there's manual, somebody is actually looking at it and trying to, you know, assign the provider to the claim, things can go hinky. I just made that word up. You know, so, but it's very important to the COHE process, because if they assign a provider that's not a COHE provider, it never shows up in OMS. And that can be a huge deal. You know, and sometimes they're caught and sometimes they're not, but just know that it's, you know, somebody looking at it, it's somebody that's trying to process 10,000 ROAs a month. They're trying to, you know, get those initiated within the time frames. It's a manual process, so things happen, mistakes are made. Easiest thing to do is just call up your COHE contract manager, you know, or whatever the process is within your individual COHE, and we can get that fixed for you, no problem. So just know that. So 78% of the ROAs are filed by fax or mail and processed by claims initiation staff. 22 are actually filed online through our file fast, and I think that that's coming up next. No, more about claims initiation, sorry. So every day there's quality assurance checks on claim initiated ROAs, you know, to make sure that there's no errors. Errors still occur, but they try, they do their best. So, and the expectation for each staff member is to input a minimum of 6 claims per hour with a 98% or better accuracy rate. So, that's their expectation every day to do that. But in order for them to not be burnt out or, you know, to get issues, you know, ergonomic issues, the staff only keys 6 hours per day. The other 2 or 4, however their schedule works, they help other areas with filing or, you know, other things. So they only key up to 6 hours per day to make sure they don't, their little fingers don't get. So file fast. So this is where a worker, a medical provider, can file an ROA online. And this is the fastest, easiest, bestest way, make that work too, to do it, because it involves the information that they put in through the file fast system goes straight into our system. There's no interpretation by claims initiation. There's no delay about getting the claim initiated. There's no 1, 2, 3 day delay. It goes straight into our system with whatever information they input and gets adjudicated that much faster. So like if injured workers and medical providers can file report of accidents, employers can file their employer report of accident online, not an actual report of accident for the worker. So that, and then the document, once they submit it, it goes straight into our system, and also the image goes straight into our system. So it's pretty much within minutes, they have a claim. And there's no delay through the mail or the fax or the imaging or anything like that. It's all linked. And providers can charge an extra $10 for doing the report of accident online. So they get the fee for doing the report of accident, but then they can get an extra $10 for doing it online. So there's a little financial incentive for them to do that. And it just helps everybody out.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Yeah.
So, completeness of a report of accident form. Mm-hmm. If the hard copy gets imaged there first, and it is complete or incomplete, and then a file fast one comes on as well, which one is chosen as to the ROA that's complete, the one that arrives there first? Because a lot of times what we're seeing is the hard copy is it is completed mm-hmm. accurately, but Providence is now putting people in place to where they are also doing file fast as well, and they're leaving a lot of the spaces blank
right.
in the provider area. So Do you know if the file fast one shows up first, does that mean that they're going to be docked on their, on the provider report as incomplete?
Yes.
If the file fast one comes in?
I think they try to look at the first one.
Yes, so it depends. It's the first one that comes in, so.
First one in the receipt.
So, well, this is where everything in LNI's, it depends. So if the file fast is the first one to come in, then that's the one, because it auto-populates the system automatically with all the data. And then any subsequent paper ones that come in don't go to claims initiation because the claim is already initiated, so that they don't need to see it. It's just extra documentation to them.
Okay.
But if a ROA is faxed in, and then 3 days, 4 days later, somebody does a file fast, and the claims initiation staff has already seen the ROA and inputted the ROA, then that's, they're looking at the first, that one.
Okay.
But if, you know, the written ROA comes in, and then a day later, file fast ROA comes in, but if claims initiation hasn't gotten to that one yet, the file fast will auto-populate the system, and that's the one that's being counted.
Okay.
So it kind of depends on what gets put into the system first, whether it's manually put in or systemly put in.
Right.
Once the system's populated, it's populated. Does that make
so
sense?
So if it's a hot claim, it's going to be done upon receipt.
Right.
But if it, the other, if it's a ROA that maybe isn't time loss related, it could take them up to 3 days to getting it.
Right.
And put it in the system.
And yes.
Okay.
And then
if
a file fast came in on the second day, that would be the one that would populate.
Okay.
So it kind of depends on who gets there first.
Right.
Who's first to the line.
Yes. Just a little feedback. I just implemented file fast at UWMC in the ED, and I told them to save a couple claims and we could do file fast, and they were all implemented. They were all done within the next morning. They were done on like a night shift.
Yeah.
And by the time we got to them in the morning, they'd already been done by the
Center. Yeah, so they're quick. So it just kind of depends.
Really,
it could be a matter of days difference, or you know, if claim initiation, you know, gets to it at 10:58 and the file fast comes in at 11 o'clock, then
and
that's
it will pop up with the message that says this has already been done on file fast.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, so it just kind of depends on who gets there first.
Okay.
So,
thank you.
Yeah.
I have a real newbie question. When I heard you say file fast and then the paper version, why are they doing two?
Because not everybody is very comfortable using the internet.
Okay.
File fast is a section of our LNI website that you go to and you input the claim information and can initiate the claim that way.
Okay.
You know, not everybody likes to do that. People like paper copies. You know, some doctor's offices aren't able to have computers in their you know.
So for the same claim, you could have a file fast and a.
In general, we hope not.
It often happens because you have, in order to complete the file fast, you have to have the provider portion completed. So it usually starts out as like a paper one just to move it through the offices or the EDs or wherever it's initiated at.
And then
someone on site's like getting all the paper copies and then doing the data entry basically.
Okay.
But you have to have certain things completed, and you have to have on the ROA, it'll say like you can do the provider's MPI or their LNI provider ID, but FileFast only accepts the LNI provider ID, not that. So
okay.
It's a
then
little.
Okay.
Yeah.
They don't
okay.
get paid for both of those, do they?
No.
And then the diagnosis has to be completed and everything.
No.
Yeah.
Only one ROA is payable on a claim.
Okay.
Whoever bills first gets it.
That's another thing. Whoever bills first, you know.
Interesting.
Yeah, so you can have multiple ROAs on a claim.
Okay.
A file fast one, a paper one. Just to muddy things up even more, you can have another ROA that another doctor in another clinic initiated because they didn't know that it had already been initiated. So you can have multiple ROAs on a claim.
I should say, when you do the file fast online, you're entering the claim number that's on the paper ID.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's how it tracks.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
Nice. Okay. That's helpful.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Sorry.
No, it's just like
a good conversation.
Yeah. So we kind of covered all this stuff. I'll just skip through employer services. So once the ROA is initiated, once it comes into the system and is initiated, an employer has to be attached to it. Who's liable? Who's liable for this injury? Who's liable for this claim? So that's where the ROA gets routed into our employer services unit. Account managers assign the claim to the correct employer and to the risk class. So they use a lot of different things to do that. The LNI claim database, they have access to employment security data. If all else fails, they can call the worker an employer or send letters, to try to figure out who's liable for this claim, who was your employer at the where you got injured at. So they also have their own processing times. Hot claims, 24 hours. Time loss claims, 24 hours. Medical only, 48 hours, but most are assigned within 24, so about a day to get that employer attached to that claim. Once the employer is attached to that claim, it then goes,
sorry.
I forget about this stuff. I'm just like in my head, I know where it goes. I forget. I'm sorry. So another thing about employer services is the difference between a single incident and occupational disease. So I'm going to assume that everybody kind of knows what those are. Okay. So easy, single incident, single employer. So with the occupational disease, what the account manager does is assign the current or last employer just like they would with a specific claim, but it's the claim manager that reviews the history to figure out if that employer is indeed liable, if there's more employer liability. They send it back to employer services with the list of employers and they figure out the percentage of liability. But while the whole occupational disease stuff is happening, the claim can be allowed because there are two separate stages. An occupational disease claim can be allowed without liability being set. That can come later.
Is that so it just moves along faster?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because it can take some time to figure out who's responsible
for
what, right? So once that's employers are set, then it comes into the claims. Claims managers finally get to lay eyes on it. And there's 28 different claim units. Some have dedicated service areas, but some have personalized services. Some deal only in file fast, some deal only in medical only, chemical related injuries, out of state / country, internal employees. So our claims aren't handled here in the building, for obvious reasons. So, they're handled in a unit up in Seattle. Yakima has a special claim service area where actually claim managers are in Yakima doing claims there. And then we have a Spanish bilingual unit that handles the majority of our Spanish claims, but not all. So just kind of, you'll see this more as you go and chat with the CMs, but just as a quick overview, claim managers have an average of 230 to 270 claims. I would say that if you probably went today, that'd actually be a little higher today. They respond to over 20 phone calls a day and answer multiple secure messages, work in three main computer programs, because I have to make it more difficult. You can't just have one big, beautiful system. You have to have three different systems working. But they also staff claims with, occupational nurse consultants and vocational service specialists and things. And this is all kind of just in a day, kind of what their caseload looks like. So as just a little fun fact, in 2015, claim managers, now you're trigger happy. Before you weren't, and now you're trigger happy.
That's why I learned how to do it.
Yeah. Claim managers paid $455 million in time loss benefits in 2015. So just as a little fun fact for that. So claim managers are supposed to be impartial claim adjudicators. They serve both the workers and the employers, making sure that benefits are assigned, are given where benefits are due. So that's what they're supposed to do. I will say that every claim manager is different. Every claim unit is different. Every claim supervisor is different. One answer from one claim manager will get a different answer from another claim manager, and that's just the way it is when you're dealing with people. So don't get frustrated, but in situations like that, the best thing for you to do if you're not getting anywhere, if you're not getting a straight answer, if you're not figuring it out, is just to contact your COHE contract manager. We're here to help remove those barriers for you, to assist you in any way to try to resolve those issues that you might be having. But just know that people are people. Claim managers are claim managers. So they may be different. Real quick, because I know Susan's like, go. We do have a Spanish word processing unit that can translate Spanish documentation that comes in, translate Spanish RLAs, as well as send a lot of our letters, orders in Spanish for us. So they do receive about 100 dictations each day and process about 150 documents each day in Spanish to try to get those sent out in the worker's language of choice. So we do have that service as well. And then as Susan mentioned, go check out the LNI website. It's a little confusing to navigate. I don't think I'm supposed to say that. But it has a lot of useful information and it's a good resource. Once you find a page, bookmark it. and it's great, so go check it out.
Thank you. Are there any questions for that whirlwind tour?
I know.
We talked about, we're trying to pack a lot in today. We talked about, oh, well, we can do this in